So what do I do if a pig is running straight at me?
Well, if he's running straight, he shouldn't, because usually they're going to try to, if they see you, they're going to try to go. They are going to go. But okay. In the event that you do, try to get behind a bush, you know, or I'm going to be right there with you. So
okay.
You shouldn't have to worry about that. Or if we got a dog with us, then we'll let the dog handle that business.
Okay.
That's what they're here for, is to make sure we get home safe.
Cool.
And in turn, we protect them, make sure we protect them as best we can so they get home safe. Hey, don't tell him. Don't tell him we're here. Shh, don't tell him.
My name is Daniel Penny.
And I'm Andrew S. Lewis.
This week on Non-Toxic, we're talking about men and their hogs, which is to say the thousands of feral hogs wreaking havoc in the state of Texas. Every year, wild pigs damage infrastructure, kill native plants and animals, and contaminate waterways with the sheer tonnage of crap they spew. Recent estimates put their damage to Texas crops at over $120 million annually. An abundance of delicious, free-range boar seems like a great thing to have until it's not. Since these wild pigs were introduced as rare big game species a few decades ago, they have ballooned into an environmental catastrophe. Now, Texas scientists and state officials are locked in a battle against feral hogs, which researchers believe to be some of the smartest mammals alive. They've tried trapping and poisoning and shooting them with machine guns, but so far, the humans are losing. Andrew, I know you're on the weird animal beat at the New York Times Magazine. Was this an issue you've been following? How did you come across this story?
This was an issue I have been following for a while. I think probably how I came across this story was Google News Alert. So I had known that feral hogs were becoming a problem, but it was pretty amazing. I was kind of craving a good long form piece, but I was so ready to read it. The story we'll be talking about this week comes from Lauren Larson, a writer and former editor at Texas Monthly and GQ, who joined me from her home in Austin, Texas. Lauren's done her fair share of celebrity profiles and cultural reporting that examines dating, beauty, and the habits of, among other things, devout pickleballers. But in her most recent feature for Texas Monthly, she gets in the mud of a different type of cultural milieu. What to do about humanity's increasingly contentious relationship with feral swine. One of the states that's most overrun by wild pigs is Texas. The story, it's a classic ride-along narrative. We meet academics and government officials scratching their heads about the state's hog problem, but also hunters offering to help in various insane ways. It's a fun piece, but it's also one that ultimately makes you think a little deeper about our relationship with nature and what nature means in a world with 8 billion humans, which is one of our favorite topics here at Non-Toxic. So let's get to it. Lauren, welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me.
So as I mentioned, you've done a lot of profile writing, some on huge Hollywood figures like Zac Efron, Chris Hemsworth, but not much on scientists, government types, and everyday people engaging with our relationship with the wild. So I'm just curious, you know, how you came upon this story and what made you sort of decide to pursue it as a long form piece?
Well, initially, I'd wanted to write a feature about specifically contraception for wild pigs. And I'd been really interested in Hogstock, which is this product that's been very enthusiastically marketed around Texas. And turns out very early in my sort of pre-reporting for this story, you know, a number of biologists told me that Hogstock doesn't actually work. And that in fact, there are huge limitations around what we can do with contraception right now. So then it became a much bigger story, which is, what else are we doing? And why are all these sort of methods that we have in place not working?
And I think it's probably important right at the top to just stop and talk about, you know, what type of pigs are we writing about here? You know, like, where did they come from? How did they get to a point where they're like so incredibly out of control in Texas and elsewhere in the US?
Wild pigs have been in Texas since, you know, basically like white people arrived. These are boars that originally came over from Europe. And, you know, if you've seen that movie, Beasts of the Southern Wild, they're very, very like those sort of giant, freaky, like prehistoric looking. They're just fabulous. And they, you know, with this story, one issue we had was trying to figure out when this sort of inflection point was, because a lot of people kept referring to like the 80s and 90s as the point when they started to kind of notice that there was a problem. Sometime in the 90s, the population just compounded itself. And in the way that sort of very, very ambitiously fertile critters can do, like rabbit style, it was like suddenly, you know, 8 pigs can become 8,000 pigs, you know?
I was just going to say that, like, talk a little, just a little bit more about that inflection point. I think you mentioned in the story, it was like gaining speed on a highway, kind of. They just hit this moment and took off.
Yeah, I mean, John Tomacek, I think, used that metaphor of a car that is gaining speed on a highway. You know, it takes a second to get going, but once it's going, it's really, really gone, especially in Texas. With the pig population, they're just so reproductively effective. And I'd been surprised by the fact that, like, maybe everyone knows this, but wild pigs are capable of multiple paternity, which is when in a single litter, a pig can be pregnant with multiple piglets from different father pigs. So they're just very, very effective. And one of the early terms that was used around this, because I had been curious about why vasectomy was not an option, like it has been with deer. And a biologist said that they defy vasectomy. And I thought that was so good. They're just so reproductively effective.
That was wild. I did not know that their fecundity was so incredible.
We made them that way. We bred pigs to reproduce like this. And so they're doing what we kind of selected them to do.
So you ride along with, you know, a few academics and government folks for a bit of a damage tour. But you choose to take us to one specific place sort of at the top, and that's a dam. So can you explain what was going on there? You know, how can wild pigs destroy a dam?
That's the question. I had been really familiar with crop damage prior to reporting this story, just these big sort of crop circles that the pigs can create just with rooting. And in working with Mike Bodenchuk and these other biologists, they are more concerned about this kind of more insidious ecological damage and structural damage. And, you know, the dam, you could see the whole backside of the dam was just sort of pockmarked with these holes, which is the rooting. And, you know, like in the short term, probably not an issue. It's more aesthetic. But in the long term, you know, Mike Bodenchuk made this point that every part of a dam is engineered, and anything that destabilizes any part of that engineering is destabilizing the dam. So, you know, what had been 50 years, we haven't done anything about this area's pig population. Could they lead to a dam collapse?
So there's a lot of legislation now trying to combat this issue. Who's behind some of these bills, and are any of them working at this point?
Well, Sid Miller has been a really enthusiastic proponent of pig control. He's the state's agricultural commissioner, and he's just a really excellent character in his own right. And he has been just sort of waging this kind of Caddyshack-like battle against the pigs in the state. And he was a strong advocate for the pork chopper bill, which allowed people to hunt from helicopters. And, you know, later that was sort of relaxed, where now you don't even have to really have a license to hunt pigs. And so we're just seeing this kind of easing of hunting regulations. And I think, you know, the tricky thing is that helicopter hunting does work. It's a really effective control method when done by these experts, like the Texas biologists use helicopter hunting, but they do it in a really systematic way. And in the story, I describe the method that they use, which is called climbing the ladder. And that's where they rustle a sounder out of wherever they're at. And then from a helicopter, they begin picking them off from the back one by one. It's really critical to eliminate the whole sounder, because if you don't, they just get smarter and they learn to sort of evade helicopters, run when they hear the propellers. And recreational hunters, you know, they're paying a lot of money to do this often. So they're a lot more likely to go for, you know, the trophy boar or just like the biggest.
And I think we should probably clear up a sounder is what?
A sounder is a group of pigs and they're matrilineal. So it's the female pigs and then typically like the younger pigs. Satellite boars kind of travel alone between sounders, just knocking everyone up. If you remember that tweet from a couple years ago in response to the Jason Isbell gun control tweet, there was a man in Texas was like, what am I supposed to do with the 30 to 50 feral pigs running through my yard? That's like the size of a sounder. Like that's very, very typical that they can be that large.
Wow. Well, let's keep going for a beat on the on this aerial hunting aspect of things. Because it's, you know, not only are the folks doing it super psyched about it, interested in it, even the biologists and other researchers, but it's kind of an internet phenomenon. So can you talk a little bit about how it's sort of proliferating across the internet and who are the characters doing that proliferation?
Well, I had to talk to Ted Nugent because the Nuge is, Ted Nugent called himself the Mother Teresa of pig hunting. There's the quote in the piece, but he actually was very, very involved with pushing through the pork chopper bill and getting all this kind of ironed out for Texans to take to the bank. There's like just tomes on YouTube of Ted Nugent shooting pigs. Him and Brian Quacka, Brian Pigman Quacka, he really kind of has his own show. And, you know, they often hunt together. But I think they, from what I could tell, they were the ones, the kind of godfathers of this sort of spectacle. And yeah, it is. It's on Instagram and it is a spectacle. It's really, really like macho and exciting. And it sort of feels like a video game. And the personalities involved are fantastic.
It is about to be tragic. They're running to the field now. They're about to die.
Okay, I got two. There's two. Ego. Three. Ego. I got three. Ego.
Yeah, it's almost like it's a pursuit that demands a massive personality because it's just so dramatic and everything about it, it's warlike. It's just completely over the top in every kind of way. So that's one form of hunting that you delve into in the piece. But I wanted to look at the other type that you go into, very different, but obviously equally as brutal. But I thought I would roll a piece of tape that you generously shared with us from that other type of hunting, and then you can kind of explain what's going on.
Yeah.
With the dogs, you can get in there and you can be a menacing presence to the pigs to where they will leave the property. Like they know that there's something out there actively trying to kill them.
Right.
So it's pretty neat, but I think so. I mean, you know, it's just another, like for me, it's just something else in my wheelhouse, you know, because I mean, if I can make money off of these hunts too. I don't, because when I told myself, whenever I start doing it for money, then I'm done, because then it's going to be more focused on the money and not me having a good time. Because this is what, this is my outlet. This is what keeps me from wanting to strangle people, you know. It's, come out here and kill some pigs, man, you know.
Yep.
Well, we're about to find out what's going to happen today, little lady.
Okay, so other than just the absolutely fantastic Texas accent there, who are we listening to? What is going on? Explain that side of the story.
So that is Jonathan Dempsey. He lives in Junction, Texas. And I found him through this podcast, Song of the Hounds, which is about hunting dogs. And he is a hobdogger. He takes out typically like 9 dogs and hunts dogs on, or hunts hogs on foot. And what that entails is the dogs will sniff out and circle and then keep in place a hog. And then Dempsey catches up. He jumps in there with a hunting knife and kills it by hand.
And you witnessed this, correct?
I did. I was kind of hoping that we wouldn't find one. I'm not really an adrenaline person, and it's a very high adrenaline sport. And, you know, we'd been out there for a couple of hours and we hadn't found a hog. And I was like, great, we got the scene, but no stress. And then we were about to head back to the truck, and suddenly all the dogs start barking. And he has one really, really skilled dog, Apache, who's kind of the first to bark. And then all the other dogs kind of want the valor, so they start to bark. So, you know, the dogs are having their own sort of spectacle. We killed two pigs that day.
Wow. Dempsey kind of alludes to it in that clip there, you know, about making money, this kind of thing. I guess I'm just curious about his fan base, how he's become, you know, a familiar face in the hog dogging community. And I'm beyond that curious about what that fan base looks like. I mean, is it men? Is it a cross section, across gender?
There is a large community on Instagram of hog dogging enthusiasts. And there are women who do this, but most of those fans are men. And there's a lot of etiquette to this community. There are sort of badges of honor for this community, like the teeth. The teeth are sort of what we'd think of as tusks on a boar. And those are very prized. It's actually not the big curlicue teeth that are the most dangerous with the dogs. It's the sort of short ones that come straight out. Because the big curlicue ones, the pointy end is sort of hard to maneuver, but the shorter ones can really kill a dog very easily. So there's a lot of valor around the teeth. I liked Dempsey because within this community, well, A, he has a lot of fans because he kills a lot of pigs with large teeth and particularly dangerous teeth. But I also liked him because he was really, really concerned about the safety of the dogs, which there are guys in this kind of community on Instagram and YouTube who don't even suit up their dogs. And Dempsey, at the top of every hunt, it takes like a really long time. It takes like 45 minutes to kind of get everyone dressed for war. And he's very, very attentive to heat with the dogs. But yeah, it's kind of like etiquette things like that. He's pretty judicious about what parts of the hunt he posts. Like, he doesn't post very like extravagantly gory moments. And so there's finesse to it. But yeah, it's this like very macho scene. There's a lot of like really positive engagement. And yeah, and there's kind of, I think Dempsey says that the hog doggers kind of look down on the helicopter guys and the night vision guys kind of look down on the hog doggers.
Do you think that tension is sort of rooted in this idea of how hunters see themselves as helping to correct a problem or even contributing to the betterment of the environment or something like that? Does it come down to that for, you know, these hunters and that tension that they're engaging with, or is it really just is it as simple as differing ideas on an element of bloodlust?
I think hog dogging is not the most effective method. When I put that in the piece, Dempsey actually pushed back during the fact check and was like, it's actually very effective. And I meant, you know, in comparison to helicopter hunting, where you can just sweep the sounder really quickly. But I was interested in the way Dempsey talked about hog dogging is very humane. He described how like quick the death is. I think I personally like didn't see it that way, because there are, you know, a couple of minutes where these dogs are sort of tugging at you before you go. But, you know, once he's in there, it is a really swift death. And I think that they're, you know, these guys are hunting under the banner of doing something good for the environment. And a lot of them also hunt deer, but like Dempsey, for instance, like spends most of his time hunting predators, and that's like coyotes, wild pigs, which predator, I don't know, or just sort of like menace populations. And so there is this kind of productive element to it. And I think he says that he's like, it's fun to be out there like drinking beers with your friends and doing something productive.
Yeah. And then I just wanted to ask, because I think listeners would be curious. So Dempsey goes into this melee He stabs a hog, kills it, and then what happens with the bodies of these pigs generally?
You leave them where they fall, or Dempsey leaves them where they fall. So do the biologists who are, you know, helicopter hunting. They've done massive amounts of research to determine that that's actually the best way ecologically for them to, you know, in terms of the cost of making sure that meat is safe to, you know, give to the public as food. That's a very, very expensive process. And there is a nonprofit called Hogs for Cause that does that, but it's not super applicable on a vast scale like we're talking about with these statewide control efforts. So yeah, you leave them where they fall. There a lot of people notice like vultures will, you know, a vulture population in the area after a hunt.
Yeah, it's the circle of life, I guess, happening. I gather that sometimes they can't be safe to be consumed by humans. Can you just talk a little bit about that danger that's possibly present there for humans?
This is divisive. Mike Bodenchuk, who's sort of the lead biologist in the story, he said he'd eat a sandwich after dressing a deer with his bare hands, but he won't eat wild pig meat. And there is a unique suite of diseases that wild pigs carry. A lot of people really object to the idea that wild pigs are somehow more dangerous for humans than other game. But I think Bodenchuk, he sees pigs like, I don't know, they pee on themselves constantly. Like they're just sort of like filthy. And I think if you're in kind of communication with them like that all the time, I wouldn't necessarily want to eat a pig after seeing them in the wild. But then you have someone like Christy Hinterman, who her project is rescuing and raising these sort of the piglet fallout from these hunts, that hunters find the piglets typically after having killed the mother, and they can't kill the piglets, so they bring them to Hinterman to raise. And her approach is like, you should just kill the piglets. Like it's very, she has hundreds now of feral pigs that have been redomesticated. And those pigs are very clean. They're sort of canine and they live on her property and just, you know, you can see that's a sort of different kind of game. But yeah, in the wild, I'm not sure I would touch it.
Yeah, no, I get that. I mean, even barnyard pigs are pretty nasty. But I'm so glad that you mentioned Christy Hinterman now, because I did want to, you know, talk about her and her role, not only in the feral pig situation in Texas, but her role in your story.
Sure. She was the last person I met, and she's the last person in the story. I'd been asking myself throughout what our responsibility actually is to handle invasive species, particularly one that we so directly contributed to, not just by bringing the pigs here, but then by moving them around the country for hunting purposes. And, you know, it is a hard, huge question. This is a problem we've created. We feel productive, as we've discussed, when we kill them. But, you know, humans are just as harmful as pigs, way more harmful, in fact. And so, you know, who's the real swine here? I don't know. And I was discussing this story with Jennifer Kahn, the writer, and she was like, see if you can find like the pig sympathizer. And that was Christy Hinterman. She like is the kindest person in the world. If anyone messes with Christy Hinterman after this story, I'll have a word, because she's just like, you know, besides the pig, she has like 30 dogs that have come to her from nearby shelters. And she oftentimes they're like dogs from people who are in like nursing homes, and she takes them to visit their previous owners. And she's just like one of those people who's like a total bleeding heart, can't say no to anybody. And she thinks about this a lot. She thinks about what we've done and sort of why these pigs are being pushed into conflict with humans. And, you know, simultaneously, I was reading the Mary Roach book about animal crime, and she deals with this very heavily. Like when a bear busts into your trash can, but you haven't secured the trash can in a bear-friendly way, like whose fault is that? And then the bear gets shot, you know, for becoming too close to humans. So I think that's a huge issue. And Adam Henry, a biologist who lives in Dallas, he spoke to this very well. He pointed out that golf courses are just this huge, expensive category of wild pig damage because the grass is so pricey and, you know, there it's like perfect ground for pigs. It's like well watered. And he was describing how in Dallas, you know, the pigs have wandered onto these sort of estate-like properties with these like beautiful lawns that are next to golf courses. Like, of course they have. So that did sort of complicate for me a story that was initially about like, how can we kill as many of these as possible? And I had a lot of difficulty with the piglets as well. Like during the hunt that I went on with Dempsey, we saw some piglets. So that's very visceral. And I think hunters, it surprised me to hear from Hinterman that hunters also feel that sort of guilt and guilty enough to bring them to her and pay child support for years.
That this is the question, sort of the paradox that looms over your entire piece, you know. Even Bodenschuck early on, he talks about how, you know, he would swerve out of the way of a pig if he saw it on the road. You know, the implication being that he does care about nature. And of course, he talks about he wants the world to be as natural as possible. But as you say, what is natural and as possible in a world with countless golf courses and track home developments, that kind of thing. So this paradox is looming over the piece, but you don't really engage with it deeply until the end. And that felt to me like a very deliberate decision. And also a decision that shows that, you know, you can exercise really good restraint as a writer. Or maybe it just came naturally in the way that you wrote the piece, but I'd love to hear more about that.
Yeah, we had Christy Hinterman and her pig sanctuary as the lead for a little bit, but the bias that I landed on at the end of the piece comes out in that section. And I wanted to do this in a way that pulls the rug out because, you know, especially like just talking to Texans, like it really is, it's this like bipartisan issue. Most people agree, even environmentalists are kind of flummoxed about how to perceive this problem because it's, or you know, animal rights folks are kind of quiet. Like I thought I'd get a lot of pushback on this story and didn't. And I think that's because there's a lot of complexity around a species like this that is so harmful to other species. And I wanted to pull the rug out, but yeah, really, I wanted to just ramp up the reader to kind of join this fight and then be like, wait a minute, maybe not, you know? And I think Christy Hinterman does that. And that's why she's so welcoming. I mean, she'll have anyone who wants to come out and visit her farm, even civilians. She just wants people to see how friendly they can be. And I had been sort of disturbed by the extent to which this species had been anonymized. It really, and I think it's the helicopter hunting that did it, because of this kind of video game quality, it becomes this sort of faceless zombie-like horde, when in fact they're very, very intelligent. They're pigs are quite similar to humans biologically in a lot of ways. And that's very, very difficult to think about when you're hunting them from above. And so kind of de-anonymizing the pigs at the very end. And, you know, Hinterman is giving them all names. She's got egg, like waiting for a belly rub and supper. And just like these pigs with these really complex backstories too, people who have raised them from pigletdom and in their homes. So yeah, that was kind of the project, was to see if I could complicate this superficially bipartisan and cut and dried issue.
With any long piece like this, where you spend time with people in the flesh, you know, you walk into a question one way and you often exit in a different way. You know, how did this piece sort of change Lauren Larson? You know, did you eat pork and now you don't eat pork? How has this piece changed the way you think about this problem?
I eat pork still. But, well, like after I went out with Dempsey and we saw these like cute as fuck piglets, that night I was driving back to Austin from the area we were hunting in, and I stopped in Fredericksburg, Texas, which is just like this corridor, like German food And I was like, I got like a sausage sandwich and like pulled out my phone. And I guess my phone was, had been picking up all the piglet talk all day. And so my Instagram feed was just like piglet after piglet, like piglets getting baths, piglets like just being adorable. And this was like babe piglets, like the cutest fuckers ever. And I think that was kind of I don't typically have moments like that in reporting where, like, for most things, you know, you can sort of shut off your head to whatever you're seeing, especially if it's sort of tragic. But something about, like, I don't know, I've never done a story like this with animals. I think I can do it for people in some ways easier than for animals. And so I did have a really visceral response after that. And that was a tough moment. But yeah, I still don't know where I've landed in terms of what our approach should be. Like we haven't found the humane solution yet, but this has to be controlled in the short term.
Lauren, thank you for joining us today. It was an excellent conversation. We appreciate you coming on to the show.
Thank you for having me.
I thought that was a great interview, Andrew. Thanks so much for sharing that. The moment that Larson was talking about at the end, where she's looking at the sandwich and having these misgivings, I guess, that really stuck with me. I don't know if you've ever had wild boar. I've eaten it. It's really delicious. I had some wild boar once on like a train coming back from the Alps, because it's like a big thing up in that part of France. They love it. And I don't know. I'm thinking a little, I guess it's different, that wild boar. I'm going to tell myself that that's European wild boar, not Texas wild boar, but I'm having some second thoughts.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I think I definitely get that feeling she described of, you know, you report out a story or you just, I don't know, watch a documentary and then you have these very visceral new thoughts about something that you completely took for granted. But at the same time, like, I've had wild boar as well, and deer, like a lot of venison and that kind of stuff. And it's just sometimes, I mean, I feel a lot better about eating that when it's taken from the wild than, I don't know, you know, going to a restaurant and having some burger that probably came from some industrial farm. I mean, for me these days, it's that type of meat eating that causes me to like spiral into the hole more so than meat that I know was killed, you know, in a wild setting.
Oh yeah. I think I wasn't yucking the ethics so much as the germs.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, that's interesting to me. I hadn't even thought about that. I guess I would just think it, you know, if the animal was like dressed properly, cleaned properly after it was killed, that it would be okay. But, you know.
But I think it's like they're not in these pristine natural environments is the thing. They're rooting around in these like dirty, semi-polluted, human-touched environments. And they eat anything. They're like garbage disposals. It's not, you know, a bison grazing on, you know, pristine prairie grass and you're hunting it and eating it. Like, this is a creature that's like, you know, just eating like plastic bags. That makes me wonder, like, should I eat something that is so indiscriminate? This was a deep dive into a world I was totally unfamiliar with. I don't think I'll be taking any of these helicopter rides with Ted Nugent anytime soon.
It's the beauty of this show, right? We get to dive into those worlds that either we wouldn't touch or didn't even know existed. But I have to say, even though Lauren probably stole it for the rest of us for a long time, if there's ever an opportunity to write more and join the Nuge on a helicopter trip, sign me up.
Okay, so Ted Nugent, if you're listening, Andrew would like to join you on a helicopter pig hunt. Sponsor the pod.
I'll be the first person to jump on board. I will witness that for sure.
That's it for this week's episode of Non-Toxic. We'll be back next week with an interview with Eric Wilson, the author of After Cooling, which is a fascinating history about air conditioning and Freon and how it is that we manage to kind of plug the hole in the ozone layer. Non-Toxic is a production of Loose Thread Studios, hosted by me, Daniel Penny.
And me, Andrew Lewis. Music is by Nathan Sharp. Art is by Sam Creasy.
If you'd like to support the show, please visit patreon.com/nontoxicpodcast, where you can sign up to receive our monthly newsletter, exclusive merch, and more. And please make sure to rate and review us wherever you listen to podcasts. Help people find the show. But nothing does that better than telling somebody you know about it. Help us spread the word.